We're taking a little trip to Norway this week.
There we are.
Norway is the only country I've ever been in where I never changed money. And,
wow.
You know, they're not on the euro, so you can't use euros there, but everything is based off of credit cards. So even the buses are all off of cell phones.
Portland's the same way.
I'll be darned. Well, this was something. It was one of the shorter films like this, like an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah, 75 minutes.
Yeah. So it zipped along.
Good.
I really didn't like it. I just did not like this film. I thought that it came around as an unreliable narrator story. But there are ways of doing unreliable narrator stories that you come in the end of like, well, that was kind of a cool thing. This was neither fish nor fowl. You know, this was just, you know, there were neighbors, but no, there's no apartment next to you. And this didn't happen. And this didn't happen. And this is what actually happened. And the end was like, who cares? You feel like even like it's almost like a magic act. You know what I mean? In a bad way. And so it was like, it didn't engage me. In other words,
when did you figure it out?
Actually not till the end, which I guess is good. You know, but
you said it didn't engage you, or are you not alive? I don't understand what's happening here.
Well, I found the story to be not compelling, and there's a bunch of things that happened that
scene behind you is just so uncompelling. Oh my gosh.
However, this scene was pretty neat. This scene was, I think, I just
pretty
like,
neat.
There was some stuff that we came together really nicely. I thought this whole seduction scene was interesting, and the beginning of the film was interesting too.
Norway.
It just got less and less coherent and less engaging as it went along.
Well, the less and less coherent is on purpose, obviously.
So,
okay.
This is the second time that I've watched this. I watched it when Jared mentioned it a couple of months ago. And I was like, because I'd seen this guy's miniseries from 2020, which is called 22 July, which is about the Anders Breivik incident, which is not the Paul Greengrass film of the same name, which is about the same thing. So that's very confusing.
I meant to watch that movie.
It's good. It's fucked up in the same way that, you know,
I love Paul Greengrass's work. Yeah.
Me too.
So but his version of it sticks around the periphery, which is really interesting. It's about like cops and reporters and stuff like that. So it has this kind of detachment from it that's pretty interesting. And so the first time that I watched this movie, I really didn't like it. I also figured out the twist immediately.
Basically
almost as soon as he goes into their apartment, I was like, none of this is real. Like
there's a couple of twists though. Like none of this is real is one
right
like light bulb you can have, but is spoiler alert just right out of the gate, if anyone wants to watch this, the four people that are watching, if you haven't seen, but who knew that she was dead in his apartment the entire time? That was the big twist.
I figured that out when they flashed back to her and she pulled up her sleeve. That's pretty
early on to even figure that out.
Yeah. That's when I was like, oh, he's killed her. Like it's like, there was just something about the way, and that's, it's really good acting by John, by the main character is,
yeah, he won a ton of awards actually for this.
There's a level of menace behind his eyes for that entire first scene that they're talking, and the way it snap cut away from it at the end, I had this like, oh man, what's going on? And then when it goes back, I was like, he did something. I don't know if I knew he killed her necessarily. I was like, maybe she's in the apartment or like whatever, or she's actually this woman or something like that. But I started to have this real unreality feeling about it. And the more unreal it felt, the less I cared. Like, I agree with Scott. Like, it did kind of feel like not a good magic trick. Like, one of those ones where they make the Statue of Liberty disappear and you know that all they did was move the whole audience. Like, and I was really bummed out about it because, like I said, I've seen this other work by this guy and I liked it. And going back and watching it again the second time, I like it a lot more.
Oh.
I was really able to appreciate the... I don't think it's as good as The Sixth Sense is at living in its reality and unreality. Like, I think one of the things that makes
about how these films reveal what is real and what isn't.
Well, and also how, like, the thing about The Sixth Sense is he never, ever, ever, ever breaks it. Like, there's no point in that movie where if you go back and you rewatch it, it feels like he's broken a rule.
Yeah, that's an interesting comparison.
That's not in doubt.
In this movie, I feel like they break the rules a couple of times, but it doesn't bother me as much on a second watch as it did the first time.
Well, because this isn't supposed to be... That's an interesting comparison, and I don't know if I would have made that comparison, because I think that this movie is more interested in... This movie is not interested in being a 100% surprise ending film as much as it does have that element, whether you have an inclination of that or not. But I think it's more interested in being in a David Lynch territory, in its second half, where it's like,
I understand, like, that
you can put things together, but you don't necessarily have to. For instance, the dinner with the single tomato and the two
that's really good
legs. Like, this filmmaker is more interested in, like, listen, I'm not going to give you a reality and then reveal something to you. He's going to make you know that you are in something that is not 100% reality at all.
Then he turns around and you see the same empty dish with his dinner on it in the other apartment.
Right. Exactly.
The woman's eating the same dinner and leaving that leftovers.
It's not just the same dinner. It's the same plate.
Plate.
The tomato and the bones.
That's what I'm saying.
The same place on the plate. Like, it's perfect. Yeah. That is perfect. Yeah. But he turns around and smacks you in the face with it, with the... when it's the hallway of his apartment.
Yeah, he said, these are my things. How did you bring them over here? Yeah. Right.
It's like that's like M. Night showing his hand kind of thing. Which
that's the thing that I'm talking about, where I just feel like he breaks the rules of the universe a little too much.
Well, if he wanted it to be what you're proposing, which is like an M. Night twist shocker ending, he shouldn't... I agree with Jared in that he was never striving for that. He certainly shouldn't have shown...
I don't think so.
He certainly shouldn't have shown the dead girlfriend in the bed twice. He should have taken out the first one, and just at the end of the film, he gets into the bed and you see the dead body laying there.
Right. And the first time, it's actually also the girl from the couch. It's not his actual girlfriend.
I know, but at that point...
Yeah, but at that point,
so many parallels between what's happening with the two women in the apartment and what's happening with him and his girlfriend.
Yes,
that I had already figured out that this is all in his head and it's a reenactment of what actually happened.
Although, there's one thing,
but it still throws you off a little bit. Like when he sees the photograph, he sees the photograph and it reveals that it's his girlfriend.
Yeah.
And then when he looks at it a second time, it's back to the regular girl. So
the other
he's
girl.
He's still intentionally, you know, revealing stuff and then taking it away.
Well, it's more Lynchian in that you never know where you're standing, you know, whereas M. Night is like, it's not, oh my God, it is.
Well, then this is like, it is Lynchian.
I think it's trying to do both things and it's not quite succeeding in either. Like, that's my problem is, like, I shouldn't be thinking about The Sixth Sense when I'm watching this.
or I shouldn't be thinking
about David Lynch when I'm watching this. Mm-hmm. Like, the problem is he's made me think about both of those things, and I don't think he succeeded at either. And that's my biggest detraction from this movie is that. I think
Scott did say neither fish nor fowl, didn't he? Yeah.
Right. I don't think this is a successful movie on that level. I think it's a very successful movie on a bunch of other levels, especially acting. I think the acting in this movie is fantastic.
It is. It's really good. Not everybody.
Up to and including Michael Nyquist, who comes into the movie and then just picks it up, puts it on his shoulders and walks out of the room with it, because he stole that movie in the very short period of time that he's in it. But that scene with the three of them in the hallway, and he kisses him and then he kisses him.
Yeah.
That's really good. Like, there's some really good shit in this movie.
There was a bit, and we talked about this being this thing being real or not, being about him hallucinating. There was one thing after it was over that I was impressed by, but this is the geography of the neighbor's apartment.
Me too.
narrow hallways. All it was all dark. It looked like John Doe's apartment from Seven.
Yeah.
And so no one would actually literally make their apartment look like that. So that kind of the art direction
The production design is incredible in this movie. Even when he goes into her bedroom and there's just CDs on the floor and just scrunchies and loads of crap, and she calls him, and it's just whoever
the
did
phone's
the
under the pillow on the
that was the art direction, it's all spot on.
It's
that was fascinating stuff.
The pigeon under the blanket.
Well, even the first time he's in that like tiny hallway, you hear something and he looks up and there's two pigeons on an armoire, and you're like, what the fuck is that about?
That was scary because they showed the edge of a suit that was hanging on the armoire and you thought somebody was standing there because you heard sounds, but it's a suit and two pigeons.
I love the pigeon callback when he's finally in the bedroom.
Yeah, this might be a European thing. We're staying in the East End and there's two pigeons used to always try to get into the apartment all the time. And we're on like a fifth floor. I'm like, get out of here.
That's just city shit. When I lived in San Francisco, I had pigeons roost on my balcony. Like, it just happens.
Yeah.
I also wanted to mention the I didn't like this film. It's not my cup of tea, but I
can guess why.
All the things that you guys are saying about what's good about it, in addition to the production design, the sets, I loved his hallway, his two different hallways where he goes into his apartment. Because not only is there no neighbors, but it's a completely different color and lighting and everything. It's completely different. The music is exceptionally good.
Oh,
the score.
Music's pretty good,
But this film is freaking brutal. The first half hour is almost unwatchable. That beating, it was like bad. I mean, not, you know, in terms of stylizing or violence, it went across some weird line with me.
Hell of a date movie.
Go ahead, Ted.
My problem is that it was not shocking to me because at that point I decided it wasn't real. So like,
oh, okay.
It was just like, okay. Like,
I think
it's a really well done scene. Like, I think it's
tremendously well done. Like we've all mentioned the acting, but also for actors to be able to pull off a scene like that is very impressive. And maybe I'm sort of the sick individual of us all, but I think that this movie I think you can be disgusted by that scene, but you can also be aroused by that scene. And I think, you know, he's just presenting it, and then you get what you get from it. And I think that I was definitely both.
I think the best part of that.
Well, that's certainly
when Anne walks.
As usual, I'm not going to disagree with you.
I think Anne, the part where you see her face and then you see it from behind and she's standing there watching. I think that part almost makes the brutality worse, because she can obviously see that they're both fucking covered in blood. They've just beat the shit out of each other and now they're fucking, and she's just like
spectator. Right.
I agree with you, Jared, also that he just presents it. He just puts it there and says, you can take away what you want from this. You know, like, he's not pushing you in one direction or another. Like, if you want to be horrified by it, if you want to be aroused by it, if you want to be both, that's up to you. That's not up to me. I'm not telling you what to do. Yeah. You know, and I think that is a really interesting choice, because I think especially in an American movie, it would be pushing you in one direction or the other.
They would make a choice.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that's good filmmaking, you know, whether it's your cup of tea or not.
I think both things can be good. I think in this case, what he did well.
All right.
Yeah.
So do you want Jim's corner first, or do you want Chris's?
Jim's been pretty quiet.
I liked it. I have trouble with criticisms of films that is like, well, it's not real. And it's like, well, yeah, it's not real. It's a movie. Documentary footage.
You're stepping up a level to the meta level, right? You're like,
no, it's suspension of disbelief. Suspension of disbelief is incredibly important in films, especially in suspense / horror movies.
Bertolt Brecht. I like being reminded occasionally, and we'll circle back to that in the second movie. But where I started getting suspicious was all the people at his job were kind of afraid of him. Mm-hmm. They knew what was going on, but they just sort of, were skating around it, you know, except for his friend who comes trying to find him.
In Fight Club, no one will ask no one will look you in the eyes and no one will ask you what happened.
My response to that is actually kind of a joke, in that I think that Norwegians are the most, or Scandinavians, the most unhappy people in the world. In terms of like, they're very aware of their kind of their mortality, and they're kind of miserable all the time. So his neighbors being miserable and his coworkers being miserable, I didn't register with me, because like everyone's unhappy.
Thanks, Scott. Yeah, you just lost half our audience.
Yeah, sorry. Hey. Yeah. Norwegian.
I've known happy.
Yeah, I was going to say, Mr. Christopherson.
I'm speaking from authority here.
So am I. How many people have been to Norway?
But, Scott's genetically been to Norway.
Yeah, I have. So my genes came from there, and I'm still, you know, it's like, oh, I'm going to die. I'll get to that.
I'll wait for, because I want to go after Chris's thing.
Okay, Chris's thing. Next door. I have never heard of this film, and you guys know I love me a good unreliable narrator movie. This one was a really tough watch. Where it lost me at about 33 minutes was really brutal sex scene, which I found extremely unpleasant to watch. It left such a bad taste in my mouth that it put me in the edge for the rest of the movie. Additionally, by the time I got to the last act, I was thinking that the gap between what the protagonist thinks is happening and what is actually happening was too vast and wasn't working for me. On the plus side, the performances are good. It makes effective use of what seems to be a pretty low budget. That's actually a pretty good point. Yeah. And running time at 1:15 is extremely brief. Ultimately, I felt the film's internal logic stretched credulity, and that coupled with a generally grim depictions of violence toward the female characters is the reason I'm giving this one a thumbs down.
Read possibly the worst review I've ever read of a movie for this.
Oh,
it's from the era. It's from around when it was made, and it's from some fucking horror website. And the dude who's reviewing it is the most misogynistic piece of shit I think I've ever seen write about anything. Mm-hmm. And like he's like, this movie just shows that all women are sluts, and like you can't trust women who don't wear bras, and like all of this other shit. Yeah. And it was just like, you're exactly the horror writer who everyone thinks horror fans are. Like it was really difficult to read, and it's unfortunate because it's one of the only reviews out there of this movie. There's so little that in English, at least, because
really hard to find.
Yes. It's hard to find. Yeah. You can't stream it. But I did look up. I mean, it won a lot of awards, you know, overseas, not here.
Right.
But yeah,
yeah, I get the feeling it wasn't cherished, as it were, you know, in terms of some other films.
Came out on DVD here one time, one pressing originally,
That's how I have it.
Well, let me roll back to what Tad pressing. Said about, like, I could see, I don't know if the Scandinavians have like an audience of like just He-Man women haters, but that guy's perspective, if you looked at the film that way, it all of a sudden turns weirdly logical.
Right.
If you watch this film just hating women, this film is like Gone with the Wind.
Mm-hmm. And he's like the hero of the, John is the hero of the story.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, and even the very end is like, he triumphed.
Just another person.
I showed her, yeah. She's dead. That's and dead right. With me. Exactly.
Yeah, it's at one point he remarks about how Anne and what's her name, are not particularly attractive either. And it's just like, what the fuck are you talking about, my dude?
Yeah, yeah.
They're both really cute.
Like, I must admit, during the violent sex scene, I just said, oh, Jared.
Oh, well, you know, actually, yeah. I did cross my mind. The oh, Jared.
I want to say that I think Chris's review is actually a way better review than he thinks it is, because if he got put off that far by the violent sex scene, then the director did the thing he was trying to do.
Did his job.
Well, that's true. He had a normal response to it.
And right. So I guess that makes my review a little worse, because I was like, oh, okay, now we're doing this. Mm-hmm. But I never bought in, I guess, to the thing in the first place so much that I was like, oh no, they're hitting each other. I was just like, okay, this is what's happening in this movie now. You know what I'm saying? I didn't get the emotional response that obviously Chris did.
Yeah. Well, okay, so I saw this movie when it came out. I mean, I rented it.
Okay.
Obviously, it was probably actually 2006 because it usually takes about a year for a picture to come over here.
Right.
At least in the video store.
At the video? No,
as far as I know, this movie was not in the theaters over here. Or I don't believe so.
I mean, New York, LA thing.
I don't think it was. I think it was barely in the theaters in Europe, actually. Like it.
I went to the video store, you know, here in Santa Rosa, and that's why I have it, because I
you stole it. You rent it and never gave it back.
I ripped the DVD.
I'll cut this part out.
What was that?
This is the crime portion of the podcast.
Hey, now we'll talk about.
I mean, it was given to me as a gift.
Middle school terrorist.
Yeah, I didn't blow up any places in Sonoma.
Call back.
In 2006 or whatever, watching this, when I saw that scene, the scene that we're all talking about, the scene behind Scott, I mean, I was so taken aback, perhaps like Chris was, maybe not like John was, but I was really, it shocked me, right?
It worked for you.
And it was that kind of thing where I was like, this is hot, but it's disturbing. I don't know what's fucking happening here.
Hot.
And I was really shocked. And I'm not, and you know, all of us watch everything.
We're pretty jaded at this point. You know? To get a rise out of you.
Right. For me to, and in a way that's not
thinking great blood.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was good.
It was the blood. That guy, the bloody guy. It was actually,
yeah. It was the right color, right?
The effects.
That wonderful thick stuff that comes out of nose and mouth when he's in the thing. It's like they have different kinds of blood they use.
The effects are good. Yeah. No, but I was genuinely taken aback, and so I think that was enough. Where I had never seen this. That kind of thing before, and all of the movies that all of us watch, we're always looking for, like, and I don't mean something that is so subversive as just trying to mess with you. I felt like, oh, this is something new that has some production merit, some artistic merit, some good acting merit. I want to see where this goes.
And David Cronenberg's Crash.
I love that movie.
Ironically,
well.
A movie that Chris likes.
All right, well,
I like that movie as well.
I was, you know, pardon me for interrupting, Jared, but I was just thinking, we were talking about the impact of that scene, how it works, how it doesn't work. I'll bet it would have been great in a theater. I'll bet it would have worked better in a theater.
Especially with the date.
Yeah. Just an audience in general. A whole group of people all reacting to that at the same time.
I mean, I bet you could.
When she hits him, it's not that bad, but when he just hauls off and cracks her in the face.
Yes.
Like,
yeah.
She hits him twice, right?
I bet you could hear.
Yeah, she hits him twice first.
She hits him twice for her second one is pretty hard.
Yeah,
it makes him bleed.
And then he just like,
I was with him at that point. It was like, okay, you need to hit her back.
That was kind of weird. See? Like, what's gonna happen next?
I bet
you just did.
I bet Tad's right. I bet you could hear a pin drop in the theater.
Reminds me of seeing Mulholland Drive in the theater. You can see it on home video, it's great, but you see in the theater that there's a sense of dread. When you watch it in a dark theater, that is, you can't reproduce on video, home video. This is probably the same thing. Film has a sense of dread to it. It's claustrophobic. It's dark. It's
claustrophobic.
Nothing matches up ever.
I think John's right. The music is pretty good. Like, it's particularly good. It gives you that sense of dread. It's claustrophobic. And I think that the thing is, I never forgot this movie, right? And I think I've seen it. This might be my third or fourth time. And I don't think it's maybe as smart as it could be, but it does have a little bit of Lynch. It does have a little bit of maybe Polanski. It does have a little bit of the Repulsion, a little bit of these kinds of stuff.
Beth, which is just blood drenched,
or The Apartment.
All right,
and I'm one of those people that scene. I mean, what's behind Scott when he comes back and he sees himself? What's happened? Mm-hmm. It's that moment of what the fuck? What the hell did I just do? What the hell? Yeah. You know, it's honestly the same moment as when he chokes her in the hallway. Oh my God, what did I just do? Mm-hmm. And you know, there's
same moment.
It is the same moment. And there's that great scene. There's that great scene where he sees the bloody towel and he has to put it in the trash compactor. It's just like these little moments, you know, the plate with the food. There's just so many little things in this that I love so much. And just, I just love this movie overall. And I think that I don't look at it as that douchebag guy that wrote that review. I look at it as like, no, this guy's awful. You know, like this is a horrible, and I mean, granted he made a mistake, but it's, you know, I love the reveal. I love how sick it is. I love, I love how sick this movie is. And I love that scene so much that we've all been talking about. And I love the reveal of her because the acting is so good throughout and he's having a conversation with her. Obviously she's off screen, but I just think it's so lovely because it's like for a while there, even though we know probably what's coming, we're just in this little moment. And then we pan down and there it is.
I'm surprised this film isn't a cult film. Like it's so hard to find now that
that's why it's not a cult film is because nobody saw it.
Nobody knows what it is.
But sometimes, if it was available, I bet it would
little
be.
Little known films get big because of word of mouth. I guess that wasn't one around here. Who knows?
If this was on Shudder right now, it would be, there'd be 10 listicles about it. Like this would be on Screen Rant and Slash Film and shit right now.
I know, probably. All right, I'll thumbs. I'm gonna do a ratchet myself. I didn't like it because the gimmick lost me, but I'm gonna notch it up a little bit for the art direction and for the acting. So,
and Chris pointed out, doing a lot with a small budget because it's a very contained.
It's tidy, which is nice. So it's not all the way down, man.
But it all takes place in that, except for the.
Yeah,
the office is probably downstairs from
I'm a little
over the same building, exactly.
Yeah. I'm a little above vertical or horizontal here.
I love this movie. I picked it.
I'm going to absolutely recommend that you guys go back in a couple of months and watch it again.
Okay.
Like, I really think, like, I was this when I first saw it, and I'm up to here after.
That's 75 minutes. That's not a big ass.
That's why I wasn't particularly upset when Jared picked it. It's like, I got to watch that again. That's short.